All right, yet another interesting and fun interview for you guys here on TYT Interviews. This one, we might have a little disagreement. Drew Roms. Okay, Thaddeus Russell is here. He's the author of A Renegade History of the United States. He teaches history and cultural studies at Occidental College. We've already discussed that it turns out there is no Oriental College, which is kind of weird to me. He taught at Columbia University, Barnard College, Eugene Lang College, New School for Social Research. That's too many schools to teach at. He's written for Reason magazine. I'm in favor of Reason, so I like that. And it turns out we went to Columbia at the same time. He was going to master's and PhD in history, and I was going to law school. But that will not be relevant, I don't think, to this interview. Thaddeus, thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
I love that name, Thaddeus.
It is a strong name, isn't
it? Yeah, yeah. It's old school.
It is, really old school. You know, yeah. Like 2,000 years ago, yeah. Old school.
Yeah. I know one other Thaddeus, Thaddeus McCotter, who had the greatest resignation letter of all time.
Yes, I'm nothing like him.
Yes, a deeply conservative from Michigan, I believe, a congressman who's no longer in Congress. All right, so Thad, Renegade History of the United States, apparently we got taught everything wrong. You're going to straighten our ass out. Mm-hmm. Tell me all about it. What went wrong? What did we learn that isn't true?
The history of American history, right, is that it started with the great men theory, right? Mm-hmm. And that's what the textbooks were full of, was the generals and the presidents and the scientists and the inventors. And that was overthrown, of course, by the new left in the 1960s, who replaced all those guys with a new pantheon of heroes. And those people were civil rights leaders and feminists and some radicals.
That was a giant mistake. We shouldn't
Union leaders. and so I was originally a labor historian, actually, and definitely a product of that new left historiography.
So you're all over Eugene V. Debs.
Yeah, all over him. So that historiography is really essential for what I do. But what I found was, when I was kind of learning it, was that that new pantheon of heroes was very similar to the old pantheon in a really important way, which was culturally. They were basically adherents to what we call bourgeois culture, or what we might call traditional conservative or family values culture. So things like the Puritan work ethic, the nuclear family ethic, very hostile to fun, drinking, sex, generally outside of marriage. Sort of qualities that modern day Republicans would identify with and celebrate. And you know, so if you look at Martin Luther King, if you look at the suffragists from the early 20th century, if you look at all the labor leaders, Eugene Debs was tremendously puritanical, as a matter of fact. You'll find that. And so that was just sort of the beginning of my problem with this. I felt like they're important. It's important that we know about them, and they did absolutely advance many of our freedoms and expanded rights for people, and that's very, very important. But there's more to life, right, than just that stuff, than institutions and economics and political rights. You know, I would sort of walk the streets of New York City when we were there at Columbia, and it's like the people I saw on the streets of New York City didn't look like these good, upstanding, wholesome social activists.
Yeah, right? They were New Yorkers.
Yeah, or people,
right?
Or Americans. And so I started to look below, even underneath this new social history that it was called, right? Look below to sort of the less savory elements, right? The people who are considered to be the scum or the lumpen proletariat, which is the Marxist term for them. People like prostitutes and criminals and drunks and slackers and gangsters. And just look and see what was going on there. And I found that what they did, just simply through their actions, they didn't really say much. They just did stuff that was bad. They created a lot of freedoms that we now take for granted.
Ah, interesting. Yeah. Interesting. Okay. Yeah. So we're going to break a lot of that down.
Okay.
I want to get to criticizing Martin Luther King later, which is not allowed on this show.
Sure.
But you're going to do it anyway. So you're going to be a renegade, I understand. Yeah. That'll be fun. And I'm with you. Like, the suffragists were a little ironically insufferable. They were enormously serious and yada yada. And so I understand the points you're making there. But they had to be. I mean, they had a serious, you know, effort that they were going to. And that's where we might get into our disagreement.
Sure.
But let's first start with the drunkards, okay, and the whores.
Right.
So I get that they are into fun and they're real people, and we have to take that into account. And I think, for example, in politics, we're insufferable in that we're, you're right, the bourgeois are all so frickin' serious, right? And they don't take into account that people are actually human beings that want to have fun, et cetera, and that those are important forces. They're not to be dismissed. I don't view that as the downside of humanity. in a lot of ways is the upside of humanity. I get that. But how do they affect history, though? That's the part I'm a little unclear about. Mm-hmm. So why would you put the drunkard next to the MLK and the George Washington? And how would you put them?
Right. So do you like The Weeknd?
I'm very much in favor of The Weeknd.
Do you ever have one?
Well,
you're a busy
guy. I wish I had more of a weekend.
But some of us do like The Weeknd, right?
Yes.
We like time off. So Puritans thought that you should work all the time, right? The Puritan work ethic. You work all the time except when you go to church on Sunday. Mm-hmm. And that was really fundamental in American culture. It still is, right? But in the 19th century, it was absolutely fundamental. So the 6 or even 7 day work week was standard. 10, 12, 14 hour work week was standard. And that wasn't just because employers required it. It was also the cultural norm. That's important to understand. Leisure was not a respectable concept. The idea of a weekend didn't exist until well after the Civil War. But when the first factories were built, right, and sort of industrial capitalism begins and they start hiring these workers, these people who came from the farms where the chickens would raise them up in the morning, they'd never seen a clock before. They had never regulated their lives according to time. This was a new thing, right?
Right.
And so they get into these factories where they're supposed to do the same thing over and over again all day long for 12, 14 hours, 6 days a week, and they just don't. they also drink. Mm-hmm. It was also standard to bring booze into the workplace, and in fact, employers provided it because it was such a cultural norm at the time.
Really?
So they would drink a lot, and they drank more and more as the week progressed, so that by Friday and Saturday morning, they were really hammered and really didn't do any work at all. They would show up and just kind of party on the job. And we have lots of evidence of this from historians. This is not just me. Many historians have written about this before, of employers complaining, I can't get my workers to work on Fridays and Saturdays and even Sundays. And then they'd be so hung over by Monday. This gave rise to the sort of informal but now forgotten holiday called Saint Monday, which was when they wouldn't work at all. Mm-hmm. And Ben Franklin actually called for legislation to end that, to sort of force workers to work on Mondays. He hated it. The founding fathers hated that culture in the cities in particular. Mm-hmm. So they broke through that idea that we're supposed to work all the time, and more importantly, they sort of created the idea just by their behaviors that the weekend and leisure and not working is okay.
So I was led to believe that we had the unions to thank for our weekends.
Yeah,
and you're a union expert.
Yeah, it's basically a myth.
Now, that's interesting.
Let me be clear, though. So the unions absolutely did fight for the shorter work day and work week, but not until the late 19th century. And they did so, and they said this, largely because of all these slacking, drunken workers who were their members and others, who were sort of falling by the wayside against the Puritan work ethic. And the union leaders, as I said, were to a man, and they were all men at the time, were firm adherents to the Puritan work ethic. And they wanted their members to be good, upstanding citizens, right, and good Puritans. And so they said, if you work our workers 12, 10, 12, 14, 16 hours a day, they're going to no longer be good citizens. They're going to be rabble-rousers. They're going to drink even more. They're going to have no stake in their workplace and no stake in their country. That was the argument that was made on behalf of the shorter work week and shorter work day. So it wasn't actually that they were interested in leisure and fun. They just wanted to keep their workers and their members better disciplined.
So let me go into perhaps the heart of our disagreement, because I've got to learn more before I can
disagree
with you.
Yeah, yeah.
But based on what I've read already,
which
is that I think that you need those guys, I mean, to maintain some degree of order. Mm-hmm. Because if you don't have the Puritan guys up top, whether they're labor or they're management, then yeah, the guy's going to want to drink all day, right?
I totally agree. So I'm not an anarchist. I'm not a nihilist. I mean, I say, I think it's on the fifth page of the book, I say, I don't want a renegade revolution. I don't want drunks and whores and gangsters to take over, because the garbage would never be picked up.
Right.
Crime would run rampant in the streets. We wouldn't be safe, right? But there is always this sort of civil war going on, at least in the history of this country, and I think in other countries as well, but certainly in this country, there's always been this conflict between sort of the keepers of moral order and social order and community and nation and workplace and my people, the drunks and the whores and the slackers.
So that's, okay, now that's fascinating.
Now, you don't want either one to sort of win, right?
Right.
Entirely. You don't want either one to win. But in the civil war, at least in this country, taking the side of the bad people has resulted in very good things that we all take for granted now, like the weekend.
Mm-hmm. How did the gangsters help?
In many, many ways. So one example is, a lot of people don't know this, but the first place that Sicilians landed in large numbers inside the United States was New Orleans in the late 19th century, 1880s, 1890s. Came in large numbers to New Orleans, right? At the time, this music was being developed in New Orleans, right? Mm-hmm. By these black guys, right? Mm-hmm. In the deeply racist South. And but these mafiosi came over from Sicily, who were basically amoral to begin with, right? And that mm-hmm. so that included not adhering to the morality of racism. So they were uh-huh. like, I don't care. We'll hire whoever. I think we can make a buck off of this new music. So Louis Armstrong's first dollar that he made from playing the trumpet in a nightclub was given to him by Joe Matranya, who was a member of the Sicilian Mafia. The mafiosi in New Orleans owned all the nightclubs that first hosted jazz music.
Because they didn't give a damn about they didn't care about anything. Blacks, they, whites. They just wanted to make money.
Yeah. Right.
God bless the
green,
Italians.
Not black or white, right? So that was one example. Another one was Thomas Edison had the patents for all motion picture technology, right? And he basically had this monopoly because of that. And he made these very wholesome pro-war, pro-family movies, and that was he was insisting on doing that. And Hollywood would have been only that forever, if not for Jewish gangsters in New York City.
Oh, that's fun.
Who were hired by the guys who became the big Hollywood moguls, the original moguls, Lemley and Marcus Lowe and all those guys, hired these Jewish gangsters to fight Edison's thugs in the streets to protect their Nickelodeons. They had these Nickelodeons that stole Edison's patents to show these movies that were very sexy, sort of burlesque kind of stuff. Edison hired these thugs to go burn down the Nickelodeons. There were fires in New York and Philadelphia burning down these Nickelodeons. They fought in the streets, but these Jewish gangsters successfully won these battles in the streets, which gave these emergent Hollywood guys time to sue Edison in court. They ended up winning. They moved out to Hollywood and created Hollywood. And also, but more importantly, they sort of created an entertainment form that was much more attractive and much more risque and much more sort of daring than Edison was willing to do.
So there is the usual conflict and hypocrisy in the in the conservatives there, like Thomas Edison, like, no, we got to have movies that are family values.
Right.
And if you disagree, I'm going to burn your house down.
Yeah, right. Right. I mean, this was all secret. Of course, he didn't let this be known, but we now know that this was going on. Another example quickly is, you know, and this always shocks people. The very first gay bars in the United States were owned by the Gambino and Genovese crime families in New York City, including the Stonewall Inn, which, of course, was the site of the Great Riot in 1969, which gave rise to gay liberation. So same reason, right? They were amoral. They're like, I don't care if they're gay or straight. It's money. It's a market that respectable, good businessmen wouldn't enter. So these bad mafiosi in the 1930s bought up all these gay bars because they saw a market there. They saw a market.
So that's interesting. I mean, it's almost always what the market will bear, right? I mean, it's kind of, that's almost the macro picture of history, right? These guys, like the respectable guys, driving towards a certain goal and then meeting the people, and the people decide what the market will bear.
Right.
Like, we will not bear a 6-day work week with 12 to 14 hours, right?
Right. I mean, but these cultural norms were so powerful that even though there was this huge market for gay bars, many businessmen wouldn't enter that market because it was, you know, not good to do that.
Right. So it reminds me of the story out of Malcolm Gladwell's book about how the white shoe law firms in New York wouldn't do mergers and acquisition deals because they thought that was dirty. That was beneath them,
right?
So, which turned out, of course, to be the most profitable thing you could do in law.
Yeah.
And they said, oh, let the Jews do it.
Yeah, exactly.
And then so they handed them the most successful part of the law practice.
Right.
And then when they were successful, they turned around and said, the goddamn Jew lawyers.
Right.
Well, no, but you're the ones who gave it to them. And it turns out if the market is interested in mergers and acquisitions, you're going to get mergers and acquisitions.
That's right. That's right.
And if someone will always is ready to profit off that, rightfully so.
Yeah.
So, okay, all that is super interesting. I just wanted to go back to one minor point about Thomas Edison.
Sure.
Because I've always been curious about him, and I got a historian sitting right across from me. So, you know, people from time to time say, like, oh, he stole a lot of stuff or whatever. What's the truth about Thomas Edison?
I don't know. I mean, well, about that stuff, endlessly debated which ideas he stole, which were his own inventions, but he was.
No, I like to break it down into simple things. Good guy or bad guy?
Oh,
go.
Yeah. Oh, he sucked. He was terrible. I mean, he was a true cultural conservative. And the thing is, imagine this, right? Imagine if Rick Santorum had a monopoly on the entertainment industry.
Mm-hmm.
That's what that was, mm-hmm. basically. That's what Edison had until those Jews broke the patent. The Jews with the criminals broke the patents.
Yeah, thank God they did.
With their thugs. Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
Okay, all right. So you're saying, to summarize a little bit, you got the Pantheon, right? And you got the Washington, and you got the MLK, et cetera. And, but in that Pantheon, they should at least be like in the Seahawks stadium, the 12th man, right?
Yeah.
And the 12th man is the one that counters all other 11 guys, right? in a balancing act,
right.
And that says, okay, hey, Thomas Edison, I know you've got all these great inventions and we really appreciate it, but we're not going to follow just your rules. Like, we got our own rules and we want to live this way. Have I summarized it somewhat decently?
I think so. Yeah, I mean, if you look at it, if you look at the typical history textbook, it is sort of like it's only the players on the field that you see in the textbook, right? And now, so those players were originally the old white guys, and now, you know, it's a multicultural mix, and, you know, you see Eugene Debs and King and Ella Baker playing on the field too, but the stands are how many is that stadium hold? You know, 50,000, 100,000, whatever it is. It's the people now, and you don't see if you take an average college or high school, certainly high school textbook, you don't see in those textbooks what people actually spend most of their time doing.
Right.
Which
is true.
Which is watching pornography.
Well, it would be a little uncomfortable to put in the history book.
Well, listening to rock and roll. Mm-hmm. You know, slacking off, going to the beach. Having sex, thinking about sex, right? Psychologists say that we spend how much of our time thinking about sex? Is that in textbooks? No. It's amazing, right? Mm-hmm. An amazing disjuncture between history and what people are actually doing. Now, in the last 10 to 15 years, I will say that many, many more historians are doing that kind of work. They are looking at those questions. But until about the 1990s, there was almost nothing on that. So
well, okay, I'm a little conflicted on that. So, you know, my sister loves watching these period pieces in old days and England and stuff. And I always, I get it, and some of those movies are good, of course. But what I always think as I watch those movies, but what about the rest of them? Like, we always see the movies about the upper class, and they're having wonderful balls and debutante, you know, dances, et cetera. I'm like, but like 98% of the people were living in miserable conditions, right? So I think I understand what you're saying, but the flip side is, the people that are, you know, having the good time or worried about sex and drinking as opposed to doing things, it's hard to describe them as actors or organized, which they're not. You know, of course they're
not,
right?
Right.
So it's hard to put that's why I say it's the 12th man, because it's hard to find, you know, to put a face to that. Do you see what I'm saying by that? So I don't know how much credit I give them. So they are who they are. They're just acting as they normally would, right?
Well,
that's why the history books cover the George Washington, because he took action. They cover, you know, Susan B. Anthony, she took action, right? So as much as I think you're right about the countervailing forces that the 12th man has, what do I do with him in a history book? He doesn't have a face, he wasn't an actor.
You explain gay liberation in part, you know, by pointing to them, right? That's one example. Prohibition. So who subverted prohibition? Right, the guys who own the speakeasies, who distributed, who brought the sleds full of whiskey over the border from Canada, who were they? Criminals, gangsters, right? Did they make history? Oh yeah, I mean, they subverted the worst law in American history, right? They really did that. So that's major.
Yeah, no, I'm with you. And and look, I think it's fair to put Arnold Rothstein or whoever up and say, here's the guy who took down, like you said, one of the worst laws in American history.
Right.
And I think that's totally fair. And you're right that it whitewashes, like, we don't want to talk about those guys. And we don't want to talk about Joe Kennedy's past. That's never in the books, because that makes it uncomfortable that he helped get JFK elected, and we love JFK.
Right.
And it's uncomfortable to talk about Prescott Bush and how he used to do deals with the Nazis.
Right.
It's uncomfortable to talk about Fred Koch, who did deals with Stalin, et cetera. So in fact, but I know because I do this on the show.
Sure. Yeah.
And when you talk about it in the mainstream press, everybody in the mainstream press gets super uncomfortable.
Right.
Because they've been at cocktail parties with the Bushes. They've been at cocktail parties with the Koch brothers. And it's really uncomfortable to mention that they originally made their family money from the Germans or the Soviets, et cetera.
Yeah. I mean, I agree with all that. I mean, that's all true, all of what you said. I'm less interested in that. I mean, you know, sort of pulling the pants off the elite is fine, and I'm all for that. Go to town. It's just that actually is done, right? It's done by the other side of on the partisan divide, right? It's like if you're a liberal, you do it against Prescott Bush, or you do it against the Koch's daddy, or, you know, if you're a conservative, you go after Joe Kennedy and his bootlegging, right? But no, I'm what I want to do is say, you know, the people, ordinary, very ordinary people have been quote unquote bad, but in doing so they've created things that we now consider to be good.
Right.
Like having a gay bar that's open. We haven't talked about the prostitutes yet, but they created all kinds of freedoms for women that are now taken for granted.
So let's get into the hookers.
Okay, so I mean, if you look in 19th century, through the 19th century, in the United States and in England, but especially here, it was not okay for a woman to walk in public alone without a male chaperone. It was not okay. You were a prostitute if you did that. You were a whore. You were called a whore. You probably were a whore because guess what? Whores were the first women to do that. Okay, now, it's like, tell a woman that now in America that was not okay to do. They'd look at you like you're crazy.
Right.
They were the first ones to do that. They pioneered that freedom, okay? Wearing bright colored clothes, right? There were Victorian proscriptions against wearing colors, right?
Mm-hmm.
Prostitutes were the first ones to do that. Red, you could not wear red without being a whore. It was called the scarlet shame of the streetwalker.
Mm-hmm.
Now, of course, everybody wears bright colors, but prostitutes were the first to do that. Wearing cosmetics, same thing. The cosmetics industry was invented around prostitution. Prostitutes were the first women in the United States to earn wages that were comparable to or higher than men's wages.
Oh, that's interesting.
Of course. They had a tremendous advantage in supply and demand, right?
So, but connect that dot one step further for me. So they start earning wages comparable to men, but then what happens next? Does that then translate to other fields, women getting more equality?
Yeah. Many of those women used those wages to invest in things like brothels, right?
Right.
Which were incredibly profitable, and many of those women became the wealthiest people, not women, but people, especially in the West, in places like Los Angeles and San Francisco and Seattle, Denver. Much of the real estate in those cities was owned by madams. Those madams, of course, because they were wealthy, had tremendous political power. You could not get elected mayor in San Francisco without Jesse Hayman's support in the early 1900s.
That's awesome. Mm-hmm.
After the 1906 earthquake, she housed and fed and clothed thousands of people who were left homeless by the earthquake. She had that much money and that much power. Same in Seattle, same in Denver. Huge tracts of land were owned by madams. They opened hospitals, schools, libraries. They did all sorts of things. But most importantly, they violated that norm that women weren't supposed to do any of that, right? Women weren't supposed to own property. Right, wives had no legal right over property in a marriage. Coverture laws, right?
Mm-hmm.
It was not okay for women to make money comparable to men's wages. That's not okay. Prostitutes were the first to do that. They just did it and they were shameless about it. It's the shamelessness that's important here, right? In all these things, it's a lack of shame that broadens our freedom, right? Ask a homosexual in the 1950s what shame meant for them, right? That was a prison. That's what kept them in the closet. That is what it was. So when the drag queens and the butch dykes in Stonewall in 1969 threw bricks at the cops and then marched in the streets and shouted over and over again, we're faggots and we're not going home, the world changed, right? They said, we're not shamed anymore. Mm-hmm. Your shame will no longer imprison us, right? And it liberated all of America.
So that's really interesting because shamelessness is a double-edged sword. And it's also the thing that I would identify as the biggest problem. So if you want to know how people get rich, I would say hard work, et cetera, will come in number three or four, being smart. What people think get people rich.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's usually shamelessness. So it's a guy on Wall Street saying, I'm going to move money around until it's in my pocket and not in your pocket. And I don't give a damn what happens to you, and I'm shameless about it.
Mm-hmm.
And the guy with morals who just doesn't have the stomach to rip people off is going to go home, right? And the guy who's richest is going to be the guy who's shameless. And I can point to industry after industry where the richest people are the most shameless people, right?
Sure.
And I'm not anti-rich. I think there's great rich people. No,
okay.
Really.
Yeah.
Like Oprah didn't do anything shameless. LeBron didn't do it. Your local doctor didn't do anything shameless. But I'm talking about, the ones that break the rules. So there's an upside to breaking the rules, but there's also a downside to breaking the rules.
Yeah, I mean, sure, they're shameless, absolutely. And often they don't care what happens to other people. But the question is, what do you want to do about that? Do you want to impose sort of a moral economy, right, on the country? Do you want to organize the economy around morality? Or do you want to make decisions about wages and prices and production quotas around morals, good and bad?
No.
Do you want to legislate that morality? Do you want to sort of determine on your own or with your friends, what is a fair wage?
Yeah.
You know, that gets very, very tricky. Yeah.
So in that sense, I'm not a classic liberal, right? I'm a diehard capitalist. Okay. I think setting wages or prices is a bad idea. And not to say that minimum wage is a bad idea, because that's a slightly different economic model, okay? Yeah. And I've said this 100 times on the show. The minimum wage can be too high, in which case it would cost you jobs, but we're nowhere near that, okay? So
fair enough.
Yeah, but at the same time, there are better models. Like, for example, in Germany, they have a better balance. So what they do is 50% of their board of a company is labor. So then it makes the business more sustainable. Mm-hmm. So it's one thing to say, hey, corporations, be more moral. Mm-hmm. Good luck with that. Okay, mm-hmm. they're not going to do that, right? Yeah. But right now in America, it's unchecked. It's amorality run amok. So a corporation says, oh, you're going to let me buy a politician? Yeah, I'll give him campaign contributions, and then he'll set the rules in my favor, and I will kick your ass. I will crush you and grind you down. And hey, look at that. We have massive income inequality. That's also shamelessness.
Right.
And one I'm not in favor of at all.
Yeah, so you're describing two things. One is shamelessness, which I agree is there. And the other you're describing that I agree with is happening is what's called corporatism, right? Which is, and it's often misunderstood, it's not the power of corporations, it is the collaboration of the state or the government and corporations, right?
Right.
And that's certainly what's going on. I am for shamelessness and against corporatism.
So you're saying make all the money you want, do whatever, cut corners, but don't involve the government.
Yeah, so as a labor historian, my first book is actually basically on this. Shame, if you want to start playing the game of shame, mm-hmm. right, and attaching it to the economy, workers lose, right? So if you make a moral argument that the minimum wage should be X, right, who still has the power in this game? It's the bosses. And so they're going to come and say, well, okay, you can have a minimum wage that's morally correct, but guess what? There's also a maximum wage that's morally correct. That's Y, right? And then you lost the argument. It becomes much more difficult for workers to have aspirations beyond this limit established by the bosses in the moral economy. So I think workers should stay out of the business of morality. I really do. Mm-hmm. My first book's on Jimmy Hoffa, mm-hmm. You know, famously amoral union leader. And I'm not a champion of Hoffa, but I am a champion of the idea that workers in dealing with employers should be absolutely shameless and should only be interested in their own interests. They should behave about their own interests the way that Wall Street guys behave about theirs.
Yeah. No, you're absolutely right about that part.
So don't play the morality game, because we will, as workers, lose.
No, but they play the morality game. I want an even playing field either way, right? Yeah. Because Wall Street will say, oh, sorry, we ran out of money, so you don't get your pensions, ha ha. Yeah. But if they need a bailout, they're like, but wait a minute, we earned this money, we're owed this money.
Oh, yeah.
There's a moral obligation that you pay us.
Yeah.
Oh, well, then what happened to the moral obligation when it came to the pensions?
Yeah, it's bullshit.
Right, of
course.
Exactly.
Yeah, no, absolutely, no, of course. So that's corporatism.
Right. So let me ask you a question about present-day America and how your theories...
We're not going to talk about Martin Luther King?
No, we are. I want to come back to that in a second. Okay, we'll conclude on you tearing down our heroes. I want your help, and I want to see how your model fits into present-day America.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So I think the number one problem in America is money and politics. So we're allowed to legally bribe politicians, and then that leads to all the ailments that we have, mm-hmm. the oil subsidies for the richest companies, mm-hmm. et cetera. I can go on for literally hours about this, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So how will the masses who are getting royally screwed by that crony capitalism, name it, right? Mm-hmm. That corrupting influence of money in politics. How will the drunkards, the et cetera, or their shamelessness, how will that help us get out of this mess?
Well, I mean, so one of the things that unites all my renegades is that they all operated in market economies, right? So, mm-hmm. you know, prostitution's market, you know, industry, business, gangsters, all the rest of them. And they found that, freedom really, you could really liberate yourself through the market economy, you know, consumption.
Mm-hmm.
And through being shameless about it. So people don't realize that in 19th century America, it was actually not okay to spend money on yourself,
mm-hmm.
right? You're supposed to invest it in sort of productive capital. So buying fancy clothes, you know, it's called living above one's station,
mm-hmm.
right? So actually, this is going to sound very strange to you, but I think that people wanting more always advances their own interests in the economy. I think it also creates industrial growth, economic growth. I think it leads to technological advances. It's why we have iPhones. It's people's aspirations for more, for better lives. So never put limits on people's aspirations, in particular people of the lower classes.
So, but what happens when their aspirations, I'm with you. I believe in free markets.
That's number one. Okay, right.
So, but what happens when their aspirations, the income inequality that we have now, runs into the brick wall of the government's not going to like, is not on your side?
Oh, yeah. Well, fight the government tooth and nail. Absolutely. Yeah, I'm an anti-statist, for sure. Mm-hmm. So Barack Obama said this, it's on YouTube, actually. I think it was when he was either state senator, maybe when he was U.S. senator, mid-2000s. It's in a video before he was really running for president, so he's more loose about it. Someone asked him what the state is. He said the state is the monopoly on violence.
Oh, that's really interesting.
He understood, and he's absolutely right. That is what it is. It's a monopoly on violence. Now, that's not fair. Right? I mean, so that we sort of agree to let them have all the guns and all the prisons and all the armies, right? Well, if we're going to do that, then, you know, if corporations get to use that monopoly on violence for their own interests, that's not okay.
Yes, right? Absolutely.
You know, so that should be fought tooth and nail. Again, that's corporatism. So it's not a small thing. You know, it's basically that's the bailout that bailed them out that came from our taxes. Why do our taxes end up there? Point of a gun, right? If we don't pay our taxes, cops literally come to our door, right? This is not, you know, this isn't like asking us for our taxes. This is violence. The threat of violence is what enforces that system. That's at the end of that system, that corporatist system. So, don't let them do it. Now, now the liberal argument is more regulation, stronger government. Mm-hmm. I think it's just the opposite.
Well, okay. So
give them less of a tool to use.
Well,
the Wall Street guys.
Okay, so let's flesh that out in a second. But first, let me agree with you. You know, that's why I always find the word terrorism a little ridiculous, right? Mm-hmm. Number one, we don't apply it evenly. We just apply it to our enemies. And if our allies, whether they're the Mujahideen al-Khalq in Iran, if they're doing terrorism that we're in favor of, we're like, hey, that's awesome, right?
Ask someone in Yemen what terrorism is, right?
Right, exactly. And our guy, the terrorists on our side are freedom fighters, terrorists on your side are the bad guys. But to the point that you were saying, when the South African government kept down blacks, mm-hmm. they used violence, mm-hmm. but they called the blacks terrorists. Mm-hmm. In Israel today, when people get really upset, but the reality is, when they run over a Palestinian home, that's state-sponsored violence. When they put up a wall, state-sponsored violence. Yeah. You try to cross the wall, they're going to shoot you, or they're going to arrest you. That's violence.
It's state terrorism. That's the only distinction. Yeah, right.
So I'm totally with you there. But on the issue of regulation, so for example, on banking, right? Mm-hmm. If you let bankers take as much risk as possible, mm-hmm. they will absolutely collapse the economy.
Well, no, they will fail themselves.
But what that does is,
let them do that. Let them go out of business.
Thad, here's the thing, right? Right now, almost all of our corporations get loans on a 30-day basis. So if those banks go under, mm-hmm. They can't provide loans to our corporations, mm-hmm. and I'm no fan of the corporations, but they are necessary, then all of them go under. And then we're in a global economic collapse of epic proportions.
Are you making the too big to fail argument?
No, that's why I am saying you are not allowed to gamble with depositors' money. You must institute a wall between the depositors' money and the money that you do investment banking mm-hmm. with, right? Glass-Steagall. Right? So that is regulation, but it's absolutely necessary regulation. And when we had Glass-Steagall, we did not have a major banking collapse for 50 years. Okay, mm-hmm. So there's an argument for regulation that works. I mean, look, cops are regulation. So to me, the idea isn't whether you have regulation or not. Obviously, you need regulation. The question is, how much? How much is appropriate for cops? How much is appropriate for banking? Yeah. And that's a normal discussion. Does that make sense?
Maybe. I mean, but I think we agree that no bailouts for those guys.
Oh, yes.
If we just do that, if we just take out that very positive regulation, that's what I call it, it's a positive regulation, right? Imagine mm-hmm. if your mom said, I'll make up whatever losses you ever incur for the rest of your life, right? Mm-hmm. What are you going to do? Now, if we can just do that, we'll change the world dramatically.
Okay. All right. But final note on all that.
Yeah.
So when the pressure builds up, what happens next? So there is income inequality, and your renegades are pissed, right? And but they're misdirected. Some of them think that we're too liberal. Some of them think we're too conservative. They don't. They're playing Republican Democrat games when that's not really the game. It's the donors versus us. So then what happens? Normally in history, so that we can use it as a guide for what happens next. Now,
what happens? I mean, it's totally contingent on all sorts of factors. There's no way to predict it exactly, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, culture determines everything, though, I believe.
Okay.
So the idea is that what we're doing right now is what makes history. And really, that's the only thing that makes history, in my view. People respond to economic circumstances in any number of ways, right? I mean, people of the same class can go in the direction of fascism or communism or social democracy or liberalism or whatever, right? I mean, there's no way to determine where they're going to go on a particular question except for whether or not an idea really sunk into their mind and really had valences for them and really made sense for their lives. And so we just have to fight the war culturally and intellectually.
That's interesting. Because, you know, one of the reasons I gave up on cable news was that in the beginning I thought, well, look, it goes into all the different news stations across the country, radio, TV, newspapers, all those three, Fox News, CNN, MSNBCs, and all this. It's in all the political offices, it's in the Oval Office. And I thought, well, it's important to get your ideas into that marketplace of ideas. But then I gave up on it because I realized the people in power didn't give a damn about those ideas. There was no real marketplace of ideas. There was a marketplace of money. And if they would do basically the bidding of their donors, and they would use whatever ideas were convenient for those purposes as a veil. But what you're telling me is, yeah, but maybe the people will listen.
Well, I mean, it's just a fact that there's a less of a market for your ideas, right, and my ideas than there are for Megyn Kelly's ideas, right, on Fox. You know, so, I mean, unfortunately, but that's just the fact. Now, we can change that, right? And so you have to figure out a way to change people's minds, right? I mean, that's what makes history, right? I mean, that's why the Civil War was fought. People decided in large numbers, for various reasons, but they decided in large numbers that we must end this regime in the South, right? Yeah. That's what makes history.
No, I'm with you. So, I'm with you. Okay. I think.
So what you're doing is the right, is the best thing. It's the only thing to do.
Because moving the powerful in this day in America is very difficult, if not impossible, because they're entrenched and they love this system. The system that's crushing the rest of us is what put them in power in the first place, and they love it.
Stop giving them access to the monopoly on violence. That's it.
See, but that's a very dangerous idea.
Why? Okay. You want corporations to be the only ones who have access to that?
No, I don't.
Or have more access to
it? But I'm very worried about anybody having access to it.
Well, me too. Reduce the monopoly on violence.
Yes,
also,
that I agree
absolutely,
with.
Yeah.
Like, so I came through these interviews. I love these interviews. I love this exchange of ideas. I learned so much from it. And so when I was talking to Oliver Stone about his project that's very similar to yours, but you know, obviously different conclusions and theories, et cetera. Yeah. And I talked to Howard Zinn, and I talked to all these guys. I talked to ex-CIA agents. And I came to the conclusion that the CIA is not an arm of the government. It's arm of corporations, multinational corporations. So like, for example, we do the coup in the 1950s in Iran. That wasn't for the benefit of the American people. We didn't get Iran's oil. The so-called American corporations got the oil and sold it, had the rights to sell the oil and profit off
it. I slightly disagree with you.
Oh, interesting. Why is that?
Oil was absolutely an objective, but it was a means to another end. To me, what's motivating policymakers, not capitalists, but policymakers, the guys who actually send the CIA in there, is power. There's simply some people in the world who are born or, I don't know, somehow develop this idea or this desire to control other people, to have political power. Why did Dick Cheney leave Halliburton? He was making good bank, right? To take this vice president's salary, and before that, the senator's or representative salary. Guy wants power. He doesn't live large. He's not having lavish parties. Doesn't live like Kanye West. He's interested in power. You know, that's what these guys are about. So the oil, they wanted the oil for sure. That's why they went into Iran, and that's why they've gone into the Middle East repeatedly. It was the oil, but the oil as a means to power. Oil to them is power, and it wasn't to get rich. It wasn't to even help their buddies in the corporations. The corporations were the ones who had the means to seize that oil and use it for the nation state.
Well, so my slight disagreement would be to, with you is, yes, you're right, that force clearly exists, right? But that the corporations then come and direct it, right? So why did we go into Iran as opposed to Kyrgyzstan? Mm. We went into Iran because Iran had the oil. Why did we go into Iraq as opposed to North Korea? Well, we went into Iraq because the people who want that power, they're like, okay, where do I wield it? And somebody comes in and says, well, it would be nice if you wielded it towards Iraq, and then we all get rich.
But the government works against the interests of corporations all the time. Takes their property, regulates them in ways they don't want, taxes them in ways they don't want. Not always, but often, right? So it's not the sort of like constant.
I think that that's the remnants of our democracy.
Again, they don't have armies. Mm-hmm. They don't. They have access to the monopoly on violence, but they don't. Google, as huge and as powerful it is as it is, can't put me in jail. Mm-hmm. It cannot put me in jail.
Well, that's not exactly right either. Remember, they went after Aaron Swartz for something that was actually fairly
legal.
They
have to go to their buddies who have the monopoly
on
violence. But as we, in 5 minutes, the LAPD could put me in jail.
Yeah.
Right?
Right, right.
Google would have to go through
have
some channels. Right,
exactly.
But they don't have immediate access to the monopoly on violence, where the state does.
Yeah.
Obama
And I'm
does.
Not suggesting, by the way, that Google put Aaron Swartz in jail. I was saying that that's an example of companies.
Oh, I get you. Oh, I agree with you. Yeah.
So,
totally.
All right. Now
criminal,
let's
disgusting thing. Yes.
So now let's give you a forum to tear down our beloved heroes.
Sure.
Talk to me about three guys: Thomas Jefferson, FDR, and MLK.
Well, Jefferson is easy. He's been done by lots of people, so to speak. I mean, well, one thing, I guess a lot of people don't know this, I suppose, but Jefferson was really one of the first major, very important Americans to invent what we now think of as what's called scientific racism. Not, I don't like black people. That's just sort of discriminatory bias, right? It's this sort of, it's an ideology, right? Based in biological claims, which are, of course, based on no real evidence, you know, that there are separate races and that there's a hierarchy of races. So his notes on the state of Virginia is really one of the first major documents that does that. Mm-hmm. Sort of lays out in sort of this taxonomy, you know, people of African descent have skulls of this shape and this size, and that
so
means
the beginning of eugenics.
That means this and that. Well, it's before eugenics, and it's bigger. Eugenics is one piece of this.
Mm-hmm.
Scientific racism is this big, broad ideology that was developed in the 19th century, and Jefferson was one of the first progenitors of that.
But he thought we should free the slaves. I mean, he didn't free his own slaves. That's a different thing. But
yeah.
So how
he was somewhat
big
about
things.
That, first of all, right? Because he never did free his own slaves. So what did he really mean by that? And second of all, he never sort of thought that they could ever become, you know, anything better than slave-like because they were biologically inferior. Jefferson was also, and this is more what my book talks about, Jefferson, like almost all the founding fathers, was profoundly puritanical. Publicly, not privately. They were all drunks privately.
And of course, Sally Hemings.
And Sally Hemings and the rest of that. Yeah, sure. Hypocrites, for sure. All hypocrites. But it's more important what people say publicly, I think, especially people like that.
Mm-hmm.
And that goes for King as well. We can talk about him in a second. But so, and it wasn't because, as I said, they weren't actually privately puritanical. Here's the trickiest argument in my book. It's that they understood that democracy is puritanical. You're not going to like this. So if you manage a place, business, company, nation, city, anything, you must put aside your own freedoms and your own pleasures, right? You must discipline yourself to get the thing running, to manage it properly, right? That's basic, right? So if you're going to hand over management of what became the United States to the people, to my drunks and my whores, right? You've got to shape them up. You've got to shape up the people radically.
Mm-hmm.
So the founding fathers, and people don't know this until they read my book, John Adams in particular, but Jefferson too, and Washington, all of them really, issued these very stern directives to American people saying, you need to stop drinking, you need to stop fornicating, you need to stop whoring, you need to work much, much harder.
Mm-hmm.
Because you're about, if we win this war, you're going to take this thing over. Mm-hmm. You've got to shape up. Democracy is by definition puritanical. It must be.
Mm-hmm.
So that's to me the dark side of democracy that people never think about. Everyone wants the right to vote and equal protection under the law. Everybody's for that. I'm for that. Sure, that's the nice side of it, and that's what we talk about. There's a dark side, which is these puritanical strictures that have come at us from politicians since the founding fathers. So if you look at Obama's speech last night, and all of his speeches, and not just his, but all president speeches, really puritanical. If you listen to how he characterizes, go back and listen to that speech or look at it again. Look at the way he characterizes Americans and the way they live. According to him, the way we live is we work all the time, we parent the rest of the time, we pray, and we fight in wars. That is how we spend our lives. That's what Americans are, according to politicians since the founding fathers, because they've understood that we need to be that way in order for democracy to work. So that's really, that's this tension that's gone on since the beginning. It's the people who don't really want to manage anything. They just want to get drunk and have fun or whatever, right? They don't want to manage the country. They don't want to be good workers. They don't want to manage their businesses. That's something the left hasn't really dealt with, is that real contradiction within democracy.
So the problem there is you got to break down what we mean by puritanical, because one side I hate, which is oppressing people, judging people, getting into their sex lives, etc. Yeah. But the other side I think is totally necessary, right? So, and maybe I'm bourgeois, and it's entirely possible that that's my perspective, right? But you need, as much as the people have to be a countervailing force to the elites to some degree have to be a countervailing force to the people.
We already covered this.
Right.
I agree with you. Yes, yes.
So the Washingtons had to tell them, hey, listen, you got to work hard.
Yeah, yeah, sure.
It's true.
Yeah. So I say it's not because they're bad guys. They're not. Even puritanical themselves personally. It's because their project required it. Project of democracy. Right.
But I don't view that as a negative.
Well, fine. That's right. But just, I guess all I want to do is sort of make people aware that that's what goes on in democracy.
Right.
And now people say to me, oh, well, look at Americans. They're all a bunch of slack and hedonists, right? They surf the web at work and they, you know, watch porn like gangbusters and the rest. And I say, well, yeah, and guess what? We're not terribly democratic either. Right? I think there's some relationship between the two. But the more democratic we get, yes, we will have more access to power, which I suppose is good, and decision making. But it also means that we become bosses. And being a boss sucks.
Don't I know it, brother.
Right?
Yeah.
It sucks.
Yeah, I hate
whether you're
having
a boss of a company or a boss of a nation, it sucks. It's worse than being a worker.
It's huge responsibility. You don't get to have fun and get drunk. You got to tell people what to do. And if you're a decent person, that doesn't feel good or comfortable.
I have converted you. Yes. Yes, you get it. Yes, that's good.
Look, it's all about balancing in my book.
Sure.
So what you're saying is you haven't seen the other side of the equation. At least look at the other side of the equation so that you can have a fuller picture of history.
And those who, well, for me, I don't moralize about this. You know, it's like you can take whatever side you want. But for me, it's just I see a lot of good that's come out of the slackers, right? The people who didn't want to be democratic, who didn't want to run stuff at all, right? Who just lived according to their own pleasures. You know, that was it. We've gotten a lot of stuff from them.
Right. All right. So we promised MLK. Let's skip FDR. People can read the book.
Yeah.
But so, which is a nice plug for your book. So that's good. I'm actually a little curious. I want to read that chapter.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. You should definitely read the New Deal chapter.
Yeah. Yeah. So Martin Luther King. What's the downside there?
Well, so Martin Luther King was his project was democracy, right? Of course, to expand democracy, to give democracy, democratic control to African Americans. Really, is what it was about. And to make them full class, first class citizens, that's what he said, right? So that meant not just, he understood this, unlike most liberals today. King really understood this, like the founding fathers. It meant not just giving them rights, political rights, formal rights, giving them a vote. It didn't mean just that. King gave sermon after sermon after sermon to black people in churches, in black churches, saying, you need to stop drinking, you need to stop having sex, you need to work hard, no matter what you do for a living. You need to adopt the Puritan work ethic. He was explicit about this. He says, we need to adopt the norms of white people. This has completely been whitewashed. It is almost in no biographies of King. You will never see it in textbooks, but it is literally online. You can go and look at these sermons. Anybody right now, it's for free. It's not like it's unavailable. It's just that historians have systematically ignored this because King has been granted the saintly position. Now, was King's project entirely bad? Of course not. Who doesn't want access to drinking fountains and seats on buses and public spaces and jobs, right? And the vote, who doesn't want that? That's desegregation, everybody wants that. And that was a tremendous, tremendous earth-shaking consequence of the civil rights movement was desegregation. But he wanted much more than that. He wanted integration, which was people living and cohabitating and working together. And then more importantly, assimilation. Assimilation into the dominant white culture. Mm-hmm. King was relentlessly hostile to black culture. People don't know this. He did not even mention jazz music until the 1960s. Mm-hmm. I mean, he'd already been a national figure for a long, long time. He called rock and roll degrading and immoral. He told people not to listen to it. He was opposed to dancing. He was opposed to emotional worship in black churches, right? The very famous sort of exuberant black style of preaching. Mm-hmm. He hated that, counseled mm-hmm. against that. And as I said, he gave sermon after sermon. He wrote a weekly column for Ebony saying mm-hmm. these things to people. He denounced homosexuality. He denounced all forms of sex outside of marriage. Of course, he was a hypocrite about that, but publicly, he was absolutely puritanical because he understood that to get first-class citizenship meant adopting not just the rights, but also the responsibilities of it.
So, as with all Puritans, I disagree 100% with them on sex. Mm-hmm. Just leave sex out of it. Mm-hmm. Because it doesn't, like having sex at home with whoever the hell you want doesn't affect your work at all, right? Mm-hmm. Like, it seems like an irrational part of puritanical.
No, it's totally logical.
That's interesting. Why is that?
And I'm the first person to make this argument is Max Weber, the social scientist of the 19th century, famous German social scientist, who said that capitalism requires the repression of the sexual instinct. Mm-hmm. That's what everyone does at work. There are other things they'd rather be doing. Mm-hmm. Most of that's sexual, right? Uh-huh. So you have to repress those desires to sit there in that cubicle all day long, to sit at the assembly line all day long.
Then
Freud said the same thing 10 years later, and others have said it as well. So no, Puritans understood that sex hates work, and more importantly, sex hates democracy. Democracy hates sex. It understands that, right? If you're going to manage the country, and John Adams said this, not me, John Adams said it repeatedly, you cannot be sexual.
Okay, but you see, I totally disagree, because look, for guys, you're going to have sex, once? If you're lucky, twice in a day? That still leaves a lot of time to do work.
It's not just the act of sex, it's thinking about it.
Right.
It's being sexual.
Yeah.
Right?
But I would disagree with the Puritans and that idea on sex. And I think that they waste their time and they fight against human nature and they crash themselves on the rocks of our DNA in trying to fight against sex. But on the other stuff that you mentioned about MLK, I don't necessarily disagree. I'm against black culture or the mm-hmm. way that they celebrated Jesus in church mm-hmm. or dancing or jazz. Of course, I'm in favor of fun and et cetera. But I think he was right that in order to get the rights that they wanted, it did come with responsibilities. And in order to, right or wrong, they had mm-hmm. to gain the respect of white Americans who held the power at that time.
Right.
And they had to be able to say, look, we're not drinking that much.
Right.
It's unfair because the whites were drinking just as much, right? But like all those things that he said that you point out there, or half the things he said, I should say, that makes sense to me.
Yeah.
I probably would have said similar
things.
It does
make sense. The logic is impeccable. It is a way to gain citizenship. It was in large part effective, right? It wasn't the only way. So another big part of my argument in the book is that the desegregation of the South really was enabled by the violence of ordinary black folk, not people involved in the formal civil rights movement. So if you look at Birmingham, 1963, pivotal moment, right, which gave rise to the Civil Rights Act. That was when the dogs and the fire hoses were used by Bull Connor. Everybody has seen these images. Everybody knows about this. Okay, so there's a myth about that. The myth is that the dogs and the fire hoses were used against these school children, these nonviolent protesters that King marched through the streets there. It's not true. Almost all those attacks by the fire hoses and dogs were against people who had come that day and surrounded the park where it was happening, who had nothing to do with the SCLC, King's organization, who started throwing rocks and bricks and bottles at the cops, brought knives, stabbed some cops, shot a couple of the cops. They were used against violent people. And then King, huge riots happened in Birmingham after the demonstrations. After that, King writes his very famous letter from Birmingham jail to the white establishment of Birmingham. And he says in that letter, and people often miss this part of it, but it's the most important part, he says to the white establishment, you have a choice, guys. You can deal with me, clean-cut Christian, good American, or you can deal with them. Mm-hmm. And if you don't deal with me, you're not only going to deal with them, they're going to go places like to the Nation of Islam and Malcolm X, and they're going to be armed. They're not just going to have rocks anymore, they're going to have rifles. So guess what happens? The Birmingham establishment a few days later sits down with Martin Luther King and signs a desegregation agreement that desegregates all of the public spaces and department stores in Birmingham. King did not have the leverage to do that without those violent black people in the streets. So it's not just being a good American that gets you over.
That, unfortunately, is an uncomfortable fact that even I like to avoid. I understand what you're saying, and I read that Lyndon Johnson, when he pushed for the Civil Rights Act of 1964, didn't do it just out of the goodness of his heart. He was really worried about the riots.
That's right. Absolutely right. That is exactly right.
Right.
It was the violence. It was the imminent violence there. And if you look at the records of sort of local Southern racist segregationists who backed down, that's what they said. They said, "I'm tired of the Civil War. I don't want this anymore. We can't have chaos in our streets anymore." And at the national level, that's absolutely why Johnson and Kennedy pushed those acts, Civil Rights and Voting Rights Acts.
But if you had just had the Renegades, there wouldn't have been a constructive solution that those people could have turned to. I think you need both MLK and the Renegades.
That's a reasonable argument. Although I think that even without MLK, eventually they would have had something. They would have desegregated the South.
Right, then you get back into the, is it the man or is it the time?
Because there have been cases in other countries in world history where that has happened, right? Where it's just been a violent opposition and they've, you know, not just won civil rights, but they've taken over the damn country, right? Like Haiti, first example of that, right?
Right. So.
But I tend to think that when you have a Mandela, MLK, a Gandhi figure, that you wind up at a better constructive, less bloody
place.
Right. Yeah, perhaps. So, but it is true, whether we like it or not, that you need both sides.
Perhaps, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
All right, this has been an awesome conversation. Thaddeus Russell, thank you so much for joining us on
Thanks
The Young
a lot.
Turks.
Yeah, yeah.
The book is A Renegade History of the United States. If you're not already interested in it, I don't think you were paying attention. Okay, all right, thank you for joining us.
Thanks, man.